Somerville. It's me, Janet Cormier, back again, Art at SCAT. Yes, yes, it's wonderful. This is the best place to be. And today, the shoe is on the other foot, as it were, or the seat is on the, never mind, that doesn't sound good. But today, I am the artist who's on, gonna be on exhibit in February. And I am the artist who's gonna be here sitting, being interviewed by the newest member of the SCAT team, which is David Ortega.
Hello.
Look at that shirt he's wearing, people. Isn't that nice? Isn't that nice? So, thank you.
Thank you, Janet, for inviting me to interview you. And you brought in a few paintings, and they all seem to be very charged politically.
Mm-hmm. That's me, never the quiet one.
And I thought we might be able to talk about each one briefly, and then I know you are also a poet.
Yes.
And so we can talk about that a little later on as well.
Oh, okay. Because I'm going to combine the two, I think, in my exhibit, too.
Oh, great. So how is that going to work, actually? Are you going to have...
I'm going to think about posting them along with these. I have some unusual frames that I might be able to do that with.
Oh, great.
So we'll see. One way or the other. I might just look like the barefoot poet, except I'll have boots on. And then I'll just go around and read during the reception or something.
That sounds great. And now, are the poems going to be complementing the paintings?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
Okay.
So I did a lot of, I do a lot of political work.
Mm-hmm.
And I've been very distressed by everything going on with Donald Trump. And I know he's the president-elect, but it's very...
The president now.
Yes, the president. Okay, thank you. I was better off thinking president-elect. But yes, so I, like a lot of people, are very concerned mm-hmm. with many of the issues, most of the things he's doing. And I use my art and my pen to work through it and share. So I was so proud to see the mayor of Somerville, Mayor Curatone, I think that's how you say it.
Joe Curatone.
Where you are, sir, you're wonderful. Thank you for taking the step to make Somerville, and just like Mayor Walsh has Boston as a sanctuary city, I am so proud of the two of you.
And Mayor Curatone actually received an award recently from SCATV and the Somerville Media Center, the first Sanctuary City Award.
And see, he deserves that. So I know you people are out there and you're watching this and you're not clapping. So now, loudly, let's just give him a round of applause. That's good. That 2 minutes, I hope the mayor heard it. I am just so proud of him. And because of that, I started with a piece that I did. And I've been working on it in my head about sanctuary cities. But this one is for Somerville. And it's Somerville, Mass, Sanctuary City Emerging Over the Wall. And so this being the wall that the president keeps saying, that Donald Trump keeps saying.
The wall between the U.S. and Mexico.
And everybody. He's building a wall everywhere. I used to think that we won't have to pay for it, because everyone else will then wall us out, maybe even Canada, so we'd be squished in there.
Yeah.
But then we would be well exercised, because then we'd be climbing the wall, so that'd be very good for health and stuff. So I did this, and I layered it. First I did it with paint to make the wall, and then because I am, anybody who has listened to the show knows, I collect things. And so I added this to give it more of a sense of the wall. And then the blue sky is that freedom that we have. And then just being proud of Somerville. So this is, and there's a companion piece that I will show during the exhibit that's another take on the Trump wall. And it's actually the same size and dimensions and all, but different colors.
Yeah, it is an interesting size. I like the orientation and the way that how long it is reinforces the idea of a landscape, and that the landscape is marred by this fence, this metaphorical sense, mm-hmm. like you mentioned, and the idea of building a physical wall, and physical walls that the current president is really championing through his actions.
What I found interesting, and I want to do something with this, is the idea that people are captives on both sides of any fence. So it's not like there's a freedom on either side, mm-hmm. when you think about it. It's like you're on one side or the other, but it's there. Mm-hmm. So it seems like you're saying, not you, but the president is saying, you'll stay on this side of the wall, but then you have all these other people who are being captured on the other side, mm-hmm. the ones who think they're free, and everyone pays a price.
Yeah.
Everyone pays a price, the children pay a price. And then I added thumbtacks down at the bottom. I started to do a US flag, mm-hmm. but then, quite honestly, I ran out of thumbtacks with the right colors. So then I added the green for money. Because mm-hmm. in Kwanzaa, right, I practice
one,
Kwanzaa, yeah.
One green thumbtack there.
Yeah, because he's all about the money.
Yeah. And myself, coming from Texas and living directly on the border, this actually does remind me very much of desert landscapes and the border on the U.S. The existing wall between the U.S.-Mexico border, like in El Paso, Texas, there's a mountain range that looks a lot like that. And just wide open skies like that, and it recalled to me the U.S.-Mexico border right away.
Wow.
Yeah. So seeing that come out in a New England artist such as yourself from
New York,
from Queens, New York,
who is not outdoorsy. And I want to point out, as I pointed out to you earlier, that coming from Queens, it is the home of. Can I say that again? As my father put it, so that way you know it's legitimate. Queens, Jamaica, New York is the home of rap and crack.
Rap and crack.
So, but it's a lot more than that too, because there are wonderful people there, but a lot of rappers. And they all went to Catholic school, so I don't know what that has to say. It does something to the vocal cords there. And so I'm gonna move on from this painting.
Certainly.
Oh, the other thing I want to say about the size is it reminds me of a flag.
Right.
It's got that feeling.
Can help you there.
Okay. And then another feeling that I have is this piece, which is I Am America. And when I do people of color, and that's primarily what I paint, I add layers because we're all colors.
Mm-hmm.
White folks are not all pure white. There's different layers of skin.
Sure.
So I just layer and layer. And this was done at a different time, but I was still angry that people were fighting off, and like, you're not an American, and you're not this, and you're, who are you to judge?
Right.
And after 9/11, there were people pointing fingers and tackling poor men named Juan. They weren't even Muslim. They were Latino,
huh.
But because of the skin color, everyone thought, oh, there's another Muslim. So I really, you know, wanted to say, we are all Americans, we are all here, and we deserve the right to be here, to contribute to the country's greatness.
Yeah, you do hear that a lot, that very charged, like you don't belong, and that really caustic phrase, go back to where you came from. But when you come from is here, you know, to not feel welcome in your own home, like a lot of people, certainly, especially right now, a lot of Arab Americans are experiencing. But historically, you know, people of color have been the disenfranchised ones in this country and have been told that and worse time and again. You know, to see the writing on your painting, I Am America, that's kind of a strong reaction to those questions, to those hurtful comments.
Oh, I want to apologize about the rap and crack thing for anyone that takes offense. It was meant as a joke, so.
I'm sure your dad didn't mean it.
I mean, no, and that was from my father, so therefore you cannot blame me, so thank you. I noticed, too, during 9/11, people were very paranoid, mm-hmm. and I tried to sort of capture the intensity, because I'm feeling that now that Trump is here, that it feels like 9/11 all over again, and people don't know who's who.
Right.
And they just hear a language spoken that's not English, and they make an assumption, and it's not who they think it is. So this is all important. We're all here together. Mm-hmm. And there are bad people out there all over the world. I'm sure there's some people in some snow country, Eskimo land or something, that are who knows what anybody's right. doing. But right. you accept people for how they present themselves. And I ask you through my paintings to accept, because that's important to me.
Now, we talked a little bit before the show about where your faces come from, the faces that you draw and that you paint. And you mentioned that they're not specifically any one person, but kind of an amalgamation of people that you see. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, I draw on the train. That's my studio. The MBTA is my studio. But I try not to draw people's faces. Mm-hmm. I might draw their pose, if their hand is in a certain way, or I was obsessed with feet, the way boots and everything were showing up.
Yeah.
So I'll do that, but I don't like to concentrate on the faces, because that to me is, that's too personal. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I'll even like look at the pictures of the posters on the MBTA. And I will sketch something just to capture the light, but I don't want it to look like that. Mm-hmm. So these faces, you know what it is? It's the energy of the train.
Yeah.
And it just like fills me. It's the most exciting thing in the world to be there and surrounded by all this energy, and it just shapes my faces, it shapes everything. And I travel with a beat up little bag of pencils, color pencils. There was an artist that was here several years ago, Jane Sherrill, and she works in color pencil, and she kept saying, you need to try them. Well, okay, I went out, I bought them, but of course I didn't use them right away. So then about 2 years ago, I started using them, and I can't give them up, you know? So I go in one room and I do this, my acrylic, because I have ADD, so I like to have something I can change quickly.
Yeah.
And then when I'm on the train, I just whip out those little pencils. And sometimes I'll drop them, and it's so funny, because I'm not even aware I've dropped them, and suddenly there's a wife saying, pick those up for her. And people come up and they give me, and I'm just like, it's great. It's really good.
That's great. That's and I know you brought some of your sketches with you.
Yes.
Did you want to look at those now, or,
no,
or maybe
actually,
a little later
let
on?
Let me go with some more paintings.
Okay, sure, yeah.
And so, thank you. Now, the next painting is this, and I did base it sort of on a photo.
Oh, another face.
Yeah, but I love faces, I really do. I'm not good at nature stuff.
Yeah.
It doesn't go well with
me. Not a landscape painter?
No, I don't even like to go camping, so I think it's all part and parcel. Mm-hmm. But I wanted to bring this child, he's Asian, into the mix of this is another person that's family, and I mean not family, but he's a kid.
Yeah.
He's adorable. And it took me a long time to do his face. It took me years. I kept going over it and over it. But I really like the way it turned out. Mm-hmm. And he's a very pensive kid, and I think I captured that. And but then it's not really him.
Right.
When you see him, it's not him. But I remember, there's something about a person's spirit that you can sort of feel. And like I said, that energy on the tee, you're feeling that energy, and it's coming from somewhere, and it lands up on canvas or somewhere.
So he's a kid that you saw on the tee?
Well, no, he's actually a friend. A friend gave me a photo, but of course, I don't do portraits.
Right.
I mean, I age kids. The FBI could use me years later.
One of those age progression artists.
This is what he'll look like. He's 6 now, but this is what he'll look like when he's 30. So I just started working with that, and then it must be the ADD. I just like, oh, enough of this. And then I just go and go and go. So I just kept going with him.
Yeah, there's a challenge to drawing kids. Their proportions, bodily proportions and facial proportions just aren't the same as adults. And if you miss it, it becomes really obvious.
Yeah, because I had adults for the longest time. And then I was on the T and this woman said to me, but she didn't speak English well, I guess, so she kept pointing. And finally I said, well, what are you pointing at? And she whipped out a picture of her daughter and showed me the roundness of her daughter's face when she was younger. And I go, that's it.
Yeah.
Oh. So then I got that angle. And then there's something about here in a child's face too. There's a softness and the puffiness, the roundness. So getting that, because all my children were looking very old. So I was trying to figure out like what to do, but it's really, and I do look at photograph books, but I look at them and then I close them and it sits with me. Everything sits in my head for a while.
So you don't use photos as direct reference, just kind of stuff to store away in your own.
Yeah, I have 1,000 billion books, so I'll just thumb through them.
Yeah.
And it's like I'm channeling something. And then I bring it to the canvas, but it's by that time, it's a group shot of billions of faces I looked at. Mm. And then those emotions I feel when I see people who are starving or people who are disabled or elderly, I just put that in there.
Yeah.
So this is him. A lot of my stuff is untitled. So boy.
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 All right.
And this is a very, I do a lot of women and children.
Oh, wow.
Because this is the most vulnerable population. And I did this. This is Madonna and Child. And I play around. It's funny because I've come back to this pattern now of using bold colors and throwing them out first and then doing the faces over them. And that's what I did here. And I love these shades. They're powerful, they pull people in, and they do it in a way I think that is not intimidating. And I love the way children too will walk up to my paintings. I did a huge one on the civil rights movement, and it was sort of, it was there because I had the Klan in one end and I used the N-word, and then another was protesters. And I put it down just to put it against the wall while I was hanging, and these kids felt so comfortable just walking up. They just engaged with the painting and they missed the hard places, but they were there in the painting, which was really, really nice.
That must have felt really good to get that response.
They were just, it was so cool. And I let them touch paintings too, because I want them to see the texture. And I tell them, don't do it in anyone else's show. But I use a lot of texture and acrylic, because acrylic you can go over. Oil you're stuck with
a
long time.
And you have to let it dry for a really, really long time.
Yeah, and if it's hot out, if it's humid, that's it.
Yeah, and another challenge, you have to have it well ventilated. Oils, there's a fire hazard. Yeah, there's just too much to have to deal with oils for me.
And don't think less of me. I feel the same way about charcoal and pastels, because that's a lot of vacuuming.
Right.
And that's like, I create enough dust.
Yeah.
I don't need that extra. So
where do you paint out of? Do you have a studio?
I paint in my home. And I use my kitchen table for my small paintings. And I didn't bring any of them, but I do paintings that are this big. So they're 3x4. They're just small paintings.
Yeah.
And when I'm showing, people like to buy those. They have sets of them. I sort of have a following. I don't want to say that too loudly, but people tell me where they hang it because it will sit on the thick part of a wall
when
you walk around. So they'll tell me they have three there, they have three someplace else on a bookcase. So they fit, they go from, was it 2x3 and then a little larger, and they just collect. Sometimes it'll be all bottles. Sometimes it'll be, I collect everything. Toy phones. I took my toy phone collection and started painting images of the old. Yes, children, there were phones that had wires, and they actually
the rotary dial.
Yeah, the rotary. So that was what I do, and so I paint that. I like vintagey. And I paint, and then my big paintings I do in my living room, because it's like a loft space, so it's wider, so I get a bigger space. But this leads me to, because I've shown a lot of women and children, and I don't want the men to feel that I have left you out. I love a man in a fedora. Oh my goodness. I think, and I found out later that my grandfather wore a fedora.
Oh really?
Even on the beach. And I just love, there's something about a man in the hat that just makes me crazy. And every time I see a guy on the tee with a fedora, I'll tell him, you look great. And I'm not trying to flirt. It's just that they look so put together because there's an art to it. And you know, there's not a cap, gentlemen, is not a hat. Okay, a cap is not a hat. This is a hat. And my father wears a lot of them. He took over, oh God, he has a whole just room almost, he used to, a table full of, he commandeered the dining room table at one point with all his fedoras.
Really, wow. And so that's where this comes
from. That and my grandfather, and I just think, and I like old movies. And there was something about a guy, there was a sense of mystery, mm-hmm. but also strength. And the way that it took style to just do it just a certain way. So I collect a few, don't wear them as much as I'd like to. I love other hats, as you can tell. This one was made by a woman from South Africa.
Oh, wow.
And I've had it for way long, and it stays with me.
Is it warm in the winter?
It is, except now I've stretched it out, so it may blow. So I have, and this is sad, I have to carry two hats. I have my rain hat and then this hat in the office or something.
Yeah.
But I just love, and I used to sell antiques, and she came in and she said, do you want to buy this? Do you sell them on consignment? But then she looked at me and she said, but this hat you keep. And I've had it ever since then.
Very nice. So what is the title of this?
This is Brother with the Pearl Earring.
Brother with the Pearl Earring.
Because you've all heard of the girl with the pearl earring. So I wanted to take that to the next level. Mm-hmm. And yes, there are several versions of this. With the hat, without the hat, but the pearl earring is there. And people get a kick out of that too. They like when I say that. And we were trying to figure out who did the pearl earring. Any of you who know, you can just drop off the answer at SCAT.
Very nice. And it fits in with your bold color palette again, the reds and the striking blues.
And I think that's also, I like to say an African palette. I usually see those colors in African and South American palettes. Usually, now I'm going out on a limb, but a European palette will have more pastels. But I like the boldness of the color. Mm. And you see a lot of it in Kente and West African art fabric. You'll see a lot of these colors. Very powerful, passionate colors. Some of them, like purples, are signs of wealth and power. And I forgot what the other colors mean, but each one of them has a meaning that, you know, for fertility, for anything, you know, not anything, but for spiritual values. Mm-hmm. There are colors and they're used in certain ways. And I find myself drifting towards that. Because I was going through a museum and I was looking at the difference between African art and European art, and I just found more, again, I can stand corrected, but more softer colors usually in the European colors.
Yeah. And you're speaking in general terms.
Yeah, in general. Yeah, yeah, like I collect African fabric and I would notice, yeah. But then it could be just my preferences too.
Yeah, yeah. Well, in the last few minutes that we have here, did you want to read some of your poetry?
Yes, thank you very much.
And again, the exhibit at SCATV through February, or the Somerville Media Center, as we are now called, will include Janet's paintings along with poetry.
Thinking Out Loud, I think, is what I'm thinking out loud with paint and words. So the first one is one about choices that we make, but it's still connected to the politics of things. And this one is just choices. It's from Bamboozled No More, which is a online magazine that I write for. How do you spend your money? And how do the places you spend your money on spend their money and your money? Follow the money, your money. Did you invest in the future, your future or their future? Remember, buyer beware, all sales are final. Because people they're not conscious when you put down money. I like to, and I tell my students, because I teach career development and some other things, put down your money where people will pay attention and work for you as opposed to against you. So there are certain stores I won't buy from, I don't care how good the prices are, because they've treated their workers badly.
Poor business practices.
Mm-hmm. And then I have this one. With all the angst that everyone is feeling about Trump and the trauma and everything's going on, I found it hard to get positive. And then one day, well, this poem will explain. This is called Interruption to Adult Angst. I love that word, too. In the midst of my adult drama, I heard the most perfect sound, a child's laughter, pure awe and happiness, giddy beyond giddy, mixed with a bit of frustration with grown-ups on the platform. How could they continue to keep their eyes buried in the newspapers and focused on the tiny screens on those phones? Didn't they see? Couldn't they hear? The child's excitement was too much to contain. The child must make them look, witness the miracle. Their dreams were about to become reality. So with a voice filled with pure awe and happiness, giddy beyond giddy, the announcement was delivered. Look, the train is coming! That child had the best laugh ever. And just when, and the doors closed just then, when after he screamed that, and I thought, they get so frustrated with us because we miss the miracles, you know? And this is how I'm feeling, like sometimes we have to go to the most simple places to find that relief. Mm. So that,
like a child's way of thinking.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And just their voices. Mm. They're not even singing, but their laughter is like singing. And it's just so amazing to me. And I just love that kid. And I've heard it before. They get so frustrated with us, but I've heard that, look, the train. So
speaking of voice, I really enjoyed hearing your voice read your poems, because there's a nice rhythm to how you want to stress certain words over others. So yeah, it was nice hearing you.
Well, thank you. I saw you looking over there, and it's like, that's me.
Yeah.
I talk to total strangers on the T all the time, so I have practice.
Very nice. Very nice. And so speaking of the tea, why don't we finish?
This man is brilliant. He
finish
does
up
segues,
with segues
in the best way
segues
ever.
Segues, connections.
So I was telling you that I draw on the tea, mm-hmm. and I'm the easiest person to buy gifts for, because I love these little books. These are just the little, you know, sketchbooks. And so this is what I do. And Jane Sherrill, again, a shout out to you. Thank you for teaching me or inspiring me to use color pencils. So this is a mother and child. They didn't look like that, but I just added them to this. So this is a mother and child. They started out looking one way. In fact, there was no other person over there. And the kid might have been crawling down here, but then I just superimpose. Again, that look of child getting disgusted with us sometimes, that you didn't get it. And let's see what else I have. I started doing weird faces with starting out with a background first,
yeah,
of color, and then adapting to a face. And again, I feel like this is African inspired.
Mm-hmm.
And this one, I just took this person and I'm trying to put it there.
Yeah.
And it's almost cartoonish, but it's the way that person's head just goes to sleep. And I didn't bring the poem, but I did a poem about benches, because so many people are sitting on these benches and you don't realize sometimes that's someone's bed. Sometimes it's the safest place they can be.
Yeah.
And so I just did this, and sometimes I add words and sometimes I don't. And then people actually look at me while I'm drawing and I'm totally unaware of it. And then they start talking to me. Are you an artist? And then I'm like, well, are you an artist? And so then I try to get them to be an artist.
Oh. Well, thank you, Janet, for sharing your art with us.
Thank you so much. This is such a nice way. This man has been so wonderful. And we just met. You know, we met several weeks ago.
Right.
But it's so nice to have you asking me about my work. I really appreciate that.
Well, excellent. And for anyone wanting to see more of Janet's work, her work will be up at the Somerville Media Center, popularly known as SCATV, at 90 Union Square in Somerville through the month of February.
And you can see part of Somerville right here. This is part of Union Square. And yes,
Oh, and you wanted me to finish by asking you some words of inspiration.
Words of inspiration. I always tell people, don't start with crayons, because you can't erase them. So what you want to do is do pencil, because there's always some kid that will tell you the story of he was drawing or she was drawing, you know, and then the teacher comes by in first grade and says, nice tree, and the kid goes, that's my father, and then they never draw again. And just do it. And if you have to do it alone and not listen to people, that might be the best way.
All right. Well, this has been Art at SCAT.
It's so funny being on the other side. Assalamu alaikum, people. See you next month.